in the years to come.
The Honourable Nanaia Mahuta.
Tēnā koutou, tēnā e tāpiri atu aku mihi ki era i waihoti i mui te aroro, kia koutou ngā tukurai, tēnā koutou, ki ngā kaumātua, ngā whaia, ngā kuia, koutou katoa e hāpai nei, i tēnei o ngā hiahia kia tutuki pai tēnei kremi, ka nuiti mihi atu. Mr. Speaker, it gives me great pleasure to be able to join with speakers before me and support the third reading of the Ngāti Porou settlement. And I was thinking, with some regards, how to approach this speech today, because we have had four preceding settlements, and the hope and opportunity that comes from a settlement process is very real. But we're having a very different conversation here with Ngāti Porou, because this settlement is in part a continuation of a conversation and a relationship that has been well established. This is a sophisticated, smart and strategic settlement in that not all the issues for Ngāti Porou have been resolved. So it will lock future governments into a continued relationship of having to work with Ngāti Porou to achieve the best outcomes in that area. And I thought to myself, I was reminded by some sage advice that was given to me by a kaumātua when I came into Parliament, and he said to me, remember, kōtiro, when you get up and speak on a kaupapa that is a Māori kaupapa, you must be able to whakapapa to that kaupapa. Don't get up and say something if you don't know anything about it. That's what he was telling me. And I thought on this particular issue, the footprints of Ngāti Porou have definitely left a deep impression on the contemporary New Zealand history. And when I think about that, I think about the bust that is at the front of the Grand Hall. And as you walk past that bust, you cannot help, as a parliamentarian and certainly as a Māori parliamentarian, to be inspired by the leadership of Apiranga Ngāte and what he sought to achieve in his lifetime. And I make mention of that particular point in history because Apiranga Ngāte, were it not for him and his relationship with Te Puia, I'm sure our fate may have been very different. I want to highlight three important strategic and significant contributions of Ngāti Porou that have endured to this day and have certainly left an impression with my people. Firstly, the contribution of the 28th Māori Battalion and that legacy of being a proud fighting people and being able to contribute towards the effort to preserve and protect who we are as a country, as a nation, for the benefit of our people and our citizens here in Aotearoa. The other contribution was really, in my mind, where Tā Apiranga Ngāte had a deep impact on Te Puia, my ancestor, and that was around land development. I mentioned earlier that we are having a very different conversation with Ngāti Porou because, unlike many other iwi, they do know what it is to develop their lands and have an economic base and look after their own people. The third important contribution was in the area of cultural restoration, our language, and our taonga. And we see very much in the components of the settlement those significant historical contributions being reflected in this settlement. That's why it is a sophisticated strategic settlement in my mind, and I'm sure a lot of iwi will be looking at how they realise the gains from it. But here it is at a fine point. In Ngāti's relationship with Te Puia, he impressed on Waikato the importance of self-sustainability through land development. Indeed, my father used to holiday in Wauku, in one of those places where Te Puia was trying to get land development back under Ngāti's times in the late 1920s. And my dad can remember going to the farm that he worked on that Ngāti and Te Puia had established. The other part was the importance of strategic relationships, strategic political relationships. It would be true to say from our telling of history that Te Puia's own relationships, certainly with the powers that be at the day, were reinforced because of her personal relationship with Ngāti, and it endured beyond their personal relationship. Then the third really important element was education. None other, I think, and many other iwi can tell a story, but I think Ngāti Porou tells it particularly well about the importance of education underpinning successful and enduring leadership for the future. And that in itself, I think, is a huge legacy, because prior to Te Puia's relationship with Ngāti, There was a huge campaign against going to schools because of our experience during the 1860s, and it was only until the relationship with Ngata that Te Puia embraced the fruits of education. And indeed, had that not have happened, my father wouldn't have been sent to Mount Albert Grammar School. So I do have a lot to be grateful to Ngāti Porou's legacy of leadership and how it has impacted on me, and that's how I really whakapapa to the conversation that's being continued here today. This is a great settlement, in my view. There are real opportunities for other iwi to learn from what can be achieved in areas like the letter of commitment and what has been trying around the cultural redress aspects of it. And I look forward to the realisation of, I'm sure, what will be a dynamic regrouping of Ngāti Porou histories, traditions, taonga, in some very unique ways for the benefit of future generations. The other, innovations, which through the treaty settlement process was something we grappled with was because the direct negotiation process cut across the Waitangi Tribunal hearing phase and hearings were suspended. Throughout the submission process, we pointed to the airing of grievances opportunity and how very real it is for iwi and people who have had an historical, grievance to tell their story. And this is a particular innovation that hasn't been seen in any other settlement. I certainly want to highlight that throughout the hearing of submissions, it was very important in some shape or form to give some prominence to people being able to air their own particular grievances so that their history could be told. And far be it from me to say the level of hurt that was felt during the submission process. I'm only highlighting really that this is an innovation and could be one that could endure going forward as well for other settlement models. And then the other unique innovation, I think, which really ties again to how strategic Ngāti Porou is around the skills value add that they can derive from the Crown, is in these unique Defence Force scholarships. Now, we all know in our own iwi, we would love to take those 10% of my cousins who may not do so well at school but could do really well in the police force and the defence forces. And opportunities like this, I think, will be looked at very keenly to see whether it can afford more tangible ways of turning lives around but making a great contribution to our country and producing great leaders. So I want to thank the Minister, the Ministers and former Ministers from Ngāti Porou who all had a hand in this in one way or another, I'm sure, for presenting this kind of a settlement to the House. It's an important day today, but as I say, we're at a different part of the conversation with Ngāti Porou as a Parliament than we are with some other iwi. And what we need to be able to say and promote, Ngāti Mea Hara Te Kumara e Kōrero mō tōna ake reka, is that where there are exemplars, we should be embracing and pushing and ensuring that they can continue to be exemplars. And where there are areas where lessons can be learnt, let's share that experience so we don't recreate the wheel. He tino a tēnei nāku, hei tuitui ki te whāriki kōrero i waiho tīmu i te aroro. Nō reira ki a koutou katoa i tēnei wā. Tēnā koutou, kia ora mai tātou.
Denise Roche.
Tēnā koe, Mr. Speaker. Kina tangata whenua o Ngāti Porou, te rā. Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. The Green Party.